stated...
When you say he, who's he?
Jalen.
Okay.
At that point, Jalen stated that he had some information about a possible weapon that was hidden in the home, and then stated that he wanted to come with us to the police department and speak with us there.
Okay. So whose idea was it to go to the police department as opposed to remain in the home?
Jalen.
Okay. And you indicated at that point, did he talk to you about the weapon in the home and where it was?
Yes.
Did he talk to you about any other specifics about what he had done that night or information that he had?
He had spoken with regards to, I believe, washing some clothes. And the laundry room is right off of the kitchen. From where we were speaking was maybe 6 feet, the entrance to the laundry room. That there were some clothes in the washer that they belonged to Deshaun.
Okay, so let's take a step back here initially. You said that you're in the kitchen, and initially Jalen Stringer is reluctant or resistant to talk to you. How do you know that? Is it based on what he's saying, what he's doing? How do you know that?
Just based on my experience of 13 years and interviewing hundreds of people, just on his mannerisms and him giving me answers but not giving me the full answers, and I knew he was kind of hesitant.
Okay.
To speak with me.
And I guess what I'm trying to get at is, did he say, I'm not talking to you, or get out of my face, or get out of here, or anything like that?
Absolutely not.
So you're having a conversation, do I understand that?
Correct.
But you don't think that he's being forthcoming?
Correct.
Okay. You indicated that his father told him what you testified to. Did his father tell him, I want you to tell him this, I want you to tell them that, I want you to, in the specifics?
No.
Okay. So do you talk, at least initially, with Jalen while you're in his home and in his kitchen?
Yes, for a short time.
You said that he talked to you about clothes. How did the clothes come up, and what significance do the clothes have?
Always ask me about the murder of
Tara
Grant.
When we arrived at the home, Deshaun was wearing...
Now 5 years after that shocking crime, we show you how Tara's sister Alicia and the Grant children are doing. We also reveal Stephen Grant's dramatic transformation.
And did Jalen indicate why he...
This was Stephen Grant then. Those wild eyes, his wild story.
Jalen didn't.
Should you be a suspect in this investigation?
I don't know.
Grant was trying to throw off the media and investigators by making up stories about his wife and her life.
She at the time was having a relationship with another man. It was mostly on the phone.
That was Grant before the truth came out in 2007. Take a look at Stephen Grant today, captured in a recent mugshot. Grant has gained a significant amount of weight in prison. He works folding laundry, but clearly isn't working out. February 9th, 2007, Tara Grant returned home from a business trip in Puerto Rico. Little did Tara know Stephen was plotting her murder. That night, Tara Grant was strangled in her bedroom by her own husband. Stephen waited a few days before reporting Tara missing, but soon her face was everywhere. People were desperately trying to locate the missing mother. Her husband Stephen seemed concerned at first, but later seemed like he was hiding something.
He stated that
if Tara is out there, what would you say?
Call the sheriff's
the day that they had together.
Don't you want her to call you?
Grant's story started to fall apart, and police suspected he was involved. Armed with a search warrant, investigators made their way inside the Grant home and discovered Tara's torso hidden in a storage container in the garage.
But his father was eating while they were playing and cracking jokes and everything, so the game took longer. And stated that during the second game,
I think I let out a scream.
Deshaun
came back. I was just horrified. I could not believe what they were
came back.
Tara Grant's remains were not only found inside her home, but also scattered in nearby Stony Creek Metro Park. A trial soon followed.
Did Jalen tell you where he was in the home or where they went to when prior to Deshaun telling him this?
Jalen stated that Deshaun said he had to tell him something. They went upstairs to Jalen's bedroom.
Okay. And what did Jalen tell you about what Deshaun did or said?
Jalen stated that when they went upstairs into the bedroom, Deshaun opened his jacket and he had a pistol, best way to put it, into his waistband and said, quote, the bitch tried to grab my gun. Nobody grabs my gun, so I shot her.
Okay. After learning this information, how did the conversation about the clothes, did Jalen tell you that he had done anything and knew anything about what happened after that, after Deshaun told him, showed him in the inside of his jacket, told him what he told him. How did the clothes come up? Why are the clothes relevant?
Jalen said that after Deshaun had told him this, Jalen got upset, punched him a couple times, and then the clothes, according to what Jalen said, the washing of the clothes was, according to him, something that was in the norm for Deshaun to do if he came and slept over.
Okay. Did Jalen tell you that he, in fact, washed Deshaun Smith's clothes that night?
Yes.
Okay. Now, while this part of the conversation was going on, do you know if any of the other police officers, you mentioned the laundry room and the proximity to the kitchen, do you know if any of the other police officers had gone over to the laundry room?
Yes.
Who did that?
I believe it was Detective Case.
Okay. Now, you said that at some point, Jalen asks if you can go to the police department to speak.
Yes.
Some more. Okay. Do you go to the police department with Jalen?
We do.
Do you continue to speak about the details of the night?
Correct.
Okay. Now, during your conversation with Jalen, whether it's in the kitchen or whether it's back at the police department, had you placed him under arrest?
No.
Okay. And in speaking with him, did you speak about, even though you hadn't gone to the laundry room, what you would expect to find in that laundry, according to Jalen?
Yes.
And what did Jalen tell you about the clothing or the items that you would find as being washed?
He stated that there was, you know, Deshaun's clothing, I believe it was a pair of jeans, shirt, and then there were some, he said the load was small, so he threw some stuff in, like, his grandmother's bed sheets and other items to kind of, fill the load up so it wouldn't be a waste.
Okay. Did Jalen tell you that he washed Deshaun's jacket, that would be expected to be found in that load as well?
I don't recall that.
Okay. You said that he spoke to you, or he said that he had information about a weapon in his home and being hidden in his home?
Correct.
Did he speak to you about that?
Yes.
Did he direct your attention to any specific location or locations in his home that the police should look?
Yes.
Where did he tell you, or what did he tell you?
Initially, prior to us leaving to the police department, he had stated that there was some items in a black, I'll call it a backpack with the strings, that was located in the heat vent in his bedroom.
In
Jalen's bedroom.
Okay.
So we went up there, he took us up there, showed us that, and then later had advised us that there was a firearm near in another heat return or heat vent in the, I guess it would be the formal living room off the front door near the Christmas tree.
Okay. And what was found in that heat vent?
I believe it was a pistol of some sort, a revolver, I believe.
Did Mr. Stringer talk to you about the footwear that Deshaun had been wearing that night?
Yes.
And did he identify by brand name or description what shoes that he had seen Deshaun wearing?
The father of the son.
I'm sorry, Jalen.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Jalen.
Yes, he did.
And what type of shoe footwear did he indicate that Deshaun had been wearing that night?
He described him as like Prada, I don't know, say maybe like casual sneakers / shoes.
Okay. I have no further questions, Your Honor.
All right, thank you, Mr. Evans.
Thank you. Sir, can you state your name again for the record, please?
Yes, sir. Detective Derek Kassab.
And Detective Kassab, you were currently employed by the West Bloomfield Police Department?
Yes, sir.
And how long have you been working there in that capacity?
It'll be 13 years this month.
13 years?
Okay. Yes, sir.
And at some point you were called to investigate the homicide that occurred in that area, is that correct?
I was asked to assist, correct.
Okay, Ms. Purcell. And you arrived at the home of the Stringers, is that correct?
Correct, sir.
Who directed you to the home of the Stringers?
My supervisor, Sergeant Grunewald, advised us over our secure radio channel that he was at the home. So my
partner. He was at the home?
Correct.
Okay. So when you arrived at the house, approximately what time was it?
It was in the early morning hours, sir. I don't have an exact time.
2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock?
3, 4, yes.
3, 4 in the morning?
Yes, sir.
There were other West Bloomfield police officers at the home?
Yes.
Oakland County Sheriffs were there as well?
Not at the home at that time, no,
okay.
sir.
Okay. And the police were inside the home?
Correct, sir.
Okay. And the father was in the house as well?
James Stringer, correct.
And the attorney for Mr. Stringer was there as well?
No, sir.
Mr. Randolph, you didn't know Mr. Randolph was at the house?
Not at that
no
time,
No one
sir.
Ever introduced you to the lawyer of Mr. Stringer that was there?
No.
Okay. Thomas Randolph, you don't know that name?
No, sir.
No one ever told you that Mr. Stringer had a lawyer?
Objection, Your Honor. Assumes facts, not evidence. It's a state.
When you decided to talk to Mr. Stringer, you had to speak with his father first. Is that correct? Correct?
No, sir.
You never spoke with his father?
The speaking was in conjunction. His father was there with Jalen at the home.
Right. And you said that the father came and sat with you and the son, Jalen, before the son began to talk to you, correct?
No, sir. It's not correct.
So the father was separate from the son when you began to talk?
No, he was present.
Okay. He was present when the interrogation began?
So it wasn't an interrogation, sir.
You were asking questions, weren't you?
It was
weren't
just...
Weren't you asking questions?
I was asking questions,
correct. You were asking questions about a homicide, correct?
I was asking...
Were you asking questions about a homicide?
Yes.
Right. And that's why you were at that house, correct?
Correct.
And his father was there, correct?
Yes, he was.
And his father let you in?
Yes.
Introduced you to his son? You didn't know who Jalen was before his father introduced you?
Yes, I did.
You knew who Jalen was?
Yes.
How did you know who he was?
Over my 13 years, I've met Jalen a few times.
Okay, you've had previous contact with Jalen in the past. And you were in contact with him in law enforcement capacity?
Yes, sir.
Objection, Your Honor. Relevance. Or is it relevant?
Your Honor, I can move forward. Okay. He says familiar. Let me get this right. You came into the house and you separated Jalen from the other officers that were in the home?
No.
You took him into the kitchen?
When I arrived there, Jalen was already sitting
already?
In the kitchen.
He was in the kitchen with who?
I believe there was another, I believe Lieutenant Roy was in there, and his father was present also.
Excuse me?
His father, James Stringer, was present.
He was present as well?
Yes, sir.
He was in the home? And they were there talking before you got there?
I wasn't talking to him, but
no,
they made
they
it.
Were.
I don't know what conversation if they were having between them amongst themselves.
How long had they been talking before you arrived?
I don't know, sir.
You don't know?
No.
And so you took over the investigation, the interrogation, you took over?
Objection, Your Honor. Defense counsel likes to keep calling it interrogation, but the witness answered that it wasn't an interrogation. And I know he went through a whole host of questions, but he keeps using that word, and it's assuming facts, not in evidence. He's characterizing it one way, and the witness already testified that's not what this was. Sustained.
You were there investigating the homicide, correct?
I was assisting, yes.
Right, and you were made aware that possible suspects of the homicide were at that location, correct?
Correct.
Right? You spoke with Jalen because you believe that he may have been involved in the homicide. Is that correct?
Not while I was speaking to him. I didn't know that at that time,
no, you didn't
sir.
Know why you were talking to him?
I was gathering information.
Oh, you didn't know he had just given another officer some gym shoes?
I had no knowledge
Jackson,
of that.
Your Honor, that assumes facts, not evidence as well.
Okay. Well,
can you repeat the question, sir?
You were aware that he had given an officer that arrived before you gym shoes.
And, Your Honor, I will object because that assumes facts, not evidence, when he characterizes it as that had already been done. The testimony previously was that didn't happen until later on in the morning, so it had not already been done.
I'm not sure about what time it happened. That's why I'm trying to figure out, was he there? When that occurred.
To rephrase the question. Okay. You didn't ask that question.
Were you aware that Jalen had given an officer of the West Bloomfield Police Department shoes when he arrived on gym shoes when he arrived on the scene?
I was not aware of that.
You were not. So you didn't talk to anybody about anything before you start to question Mr. Stringer?
Correct.
And you said that he wasn't a suspect?
Not at that time.
He wasn't a person of interest?
No.
Then why were you at his house? If he wasn't a suspect and he wasn't a person of interest, why were you at his house?
I was following an order from my sergeant to come to the house.
And, you were following the order, but you asked, what was the purpose of me being here? Did you ask your sergeant, what was the purpose of me being here? What am I to do? Your Honor,
somebody's saying something in the back. Please refrain from talking or I'll ask you to leave the courtroom, please.
There's also a potential witness that's in the courtroom. It's the attorney for Mr. Stringer that was also on the scene, who's currently in the courtroom now, and there's a sequestration order that was put into effect, and okay. I would ask that it be honored.
If there's a witness in the courtroom, I don't know who you're referencing, Mr. Evans.
That's Mr. Thomas Randolph is the attorney for Mr. Stringer.
Okay, is he being called as a witness?
I don't have.
He was on the scene.
I don't believe I'm calling him as a witness, but if he's a potential witness, no, he should not be in the courtroom.
All right. Mr. Randolph, I will ask you to exit, please, because there is a sequestration order in effect. Thank you. Go ahead, Mr. Randolph.
Thank you, Your Honor. So, at some point, you sat down with Jalen to talk, correct?
Correct, sir.
Your Honor, it's my understanding that James Stringer is in the back of the courtroom right now also, and he was sequestered last time and he was asked to leave the courtroom. I did not realize that he was in here, but I'm asking that if James Stringer is in the courtroom, he needs to be sequestered. If Javon Stringer is in the courtroom, if Siobhan Stringer is in the courtroom, any of the members of the family that were at the Stringer home on December 9th, 2016 and December 8th, 2016, I would ask that they be sequestered and removed from the courtroom. If there is a Ben Pearl, if there is...
Do you not know your witnesses?
They are not my witnesses necessarily, Your Honor, but they are people that the defendants, or we have information that the defendants were in contact with. They're sitting on the defense side. I don't know why they remained in the courtroom. They're here in support of the defendants.
Hold on, Your Honor, talk about defense side. Defense, there is no defense in prosecutor side. And I just think that's disingenuous to try to make those people associated with my client, and he doesn't even know them.
If you could please go through your name of witnesses, and maybe you want to recite them.
Certainly.
If you have not met some of these witnesses, and we will make sure the sequestration order is complied with. So why don't you go ahead and read those names.
Thank you. Is it Jonathan Gilpin in the courtroom? Nathan Cumbo. Quinn Pierakis? No, she says. Benjamin Pearl, Christopher Fellin. The court excluded the victim's mother, Marina Pesterl, from the sequestration order under the crime victim's rights.
We have no objection for her being here.
Anita Pasner, Afsar Roney. Mr. Yoon is not here today. He already took his testimony. Sherry Goldsmith. Dennis Mackey, Trevor Dahm. Thomas Steiger, James Stringer, Sharon Stringer, Dylan Abbo, Justin Wonder, Cassandra Lark, Darshay Edwards, Stone Feroz, Ann Tortolot, Your Honor, and I guess I would just place for the record, because I know that the court is well aware, this is a probable cause hearing, and there are outstanding, there's evidence that's being tested and analyzed, including phones and phone records. So if I can simply make a statement that I may not have every single name of every single person who either or both of these defendants would have communicated with. So if there is a person in this courtroom that communicated with Deshaun Smith and or Jalen Stringer on December 8th, 2016, December 9th, 2016, and in the ensuing days, I would ask that they be sequestered from the courtroom at this point because they could potentially be witnesses should the analysis determine that they had communications with these defendants or one or the other.
That's a pretty broad brush, Your Honor, for her to have the authority to do that.
Well, it is a broad brush, but what's your objection?
That they're not on their witness list now, so they're not witnesses to be sequestered.
Well, how is it prejudicial if I grant it?
They have a right to be here.
Mr. Evans?
I have no objection. She's doing the best she can, in my opinion, okay, to try to clear the courtroom of any prejudice. And for those she knows, she can identify. If she doesn't know, we'll deal with that later.
I assume then the identified names that you read, those individuals have left the court.
Yes, Your Honor, that's my understanding.
So if there's anyone else that falls in the latter category that she mentioned, based on evidence that has not yet been analyzed, please exit the courtroom. Okay. Go ahead, Mr. Evans.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Your Honor.
This is Detective Cassad.
Yes, sir.
So at some point, you were introduced to Jalen, correct?
Correct.
He was in the kitchen with two other officers, I mean, with the officer and his dad, correct?
Correct.
You don't know what they were talking about, correct?
No, sir.
You don't know if they were talking about the crime, correct?
Correct.
Right, and you were not aware that he had already hired a lawyer and the lawyer was present at the scene when you arrived. You were not made aware that he had a lawyer that was just excused from the courtroom that was on the scene and that has spoke on his behalf before you arrived.
Correct. I did not see any attorney there.
Okay. Now, you said that you were told to come over to follow or continue your investigation and you didn't. Did you believe that either one of these two young men were a suspect at that time or not?
I didn't have all the information with regards to the case.
I understand that, but did you believe that they may be a suspect, either one?
No, not at that time.
You didn't believe that they were suspect?
I didn't have any information to believe that, sir.
Well, why were you there asking them questions about the crime then? What was your basis of coming to that home and questioning them about the crime? What did you believe that they knew about the crime?
Was just gathering information.
I understand that, but you're just not randomly gathering the information. You're at someone's house.
Yes.
What was it at 2:30 in the morning? So what was it that you were relying on that you felt it was necessary to ask them questions about the crime? What was it that you, if you didn't think he was a suspect, what did you think your purpose of talking to him was for?
To gather information with regards to, any information with regards to the crime.
Why'd you pick him?
I was given the address and the names by my supervisor.
And you weren't told what information that they may be able to provide to you? You were never told these young men may be able to provide some information in relationship to the crime and told what information they possibly could have?
I don't know if I understand the question, sir.
What part of it don't you understand?
Can you rephrase it or repeat it, please?
I mean, when you said you got directives from a supervisor, correct?
Correct.
Supervisor instructed you to come out to that location, correct?
Yes, sir.
Upon receiving your direction from the supervisor, I'm sure he told you that these individuals are persons of interest and this is reason why.
No, I had already known the information with regards to what had happened.
I understand what happened, but their relationship to that, what had happened. You went to that house for a purpose.
Correct. Their names were given to us, and I say us as the investigators on scene, by the officer that had contact with them earlier that night.
Okay. As being what? Names for what?
Names that she had, Officer Daly had ran across them at the boat launch, Orchard Lake boat launch.
Okay, but how far is the boat launch from where the burnt car was located?
Less than a mile.
Less than a mile.
Yes,
so
sir.
It wasn't at the boat launch.
No, sir.
Right. And you were talking to them because you wanted to know something about an incident that occurred a mile away.
Correct.
And you didn't know what relationship they may have had to something that occurred a mile away, correct?
You correct. That's why we're talking to
them. Okay. So when you initially start to talk to Jalen, his father didn't leave the room, did he?
I don't believe so, no.
Okay. And you asked him a couple of questions to tell him, for him to tell you what had occurred behind Pine Lake Elementary, correct?
Correct.
That's what you did, right?
Yes.
And when you did that, he began to tell you something, isn't that right?
Yes.
Right? And this is the part I have a question with. You weren't satisfied with his responses, correct? You weren't satisfied with what he was telling you.
At that particular time, no.
What did he tell you that caused you to believe or not to be satisfied with his answers?
He wasn't really telling me anything.
You have a copy of the police report?
Yes.
When you use the word very resistant, that means he was not open and candid to you, correct?
Sir, I don't know if that's in my police report.
Did you prepare a police report?
Correct, but I don't know. I don't believe using the word very resistant. If I have, then I have, but let's see if you want to show me a copy.
I think the prosecutor even asked you on direct examination about resistance, and you agreed he was a resistant.
Correct.
So what is it?
I believe I used the word reluctant.
Well, let me show you. Maybe you could. May I approach the witness, Sean?
Do you wish to see a report, Detective?
Yes, ma'am.
Did you prepare a report?
Yes, I did.
Okay. And may I approach you?
Sure.
Is this a copy of your report?
No, that's not my copy. Not my report, sir.
Well, this is not your report. 1 second, yeah. That's somebody from your department.
Yes, sir. That's Sergeant Grunwald.
Okay. But you agree you said he was resistant or he wasn't resistant when you talked to him?
I think I wouldn't maybe use the word resistant. I just think he didn't want to speak to us for
whatever his reasons. He didn't want to speak to you, right?
I'm sorry, sir?
He didn't want to speak to you?
I mean, he was communicating. He was talking to me, but he wasn't communicating with regards to the situation at hand.
And was that sergeant present when you were talking to him? Sergeant that we just made reference to?
Sergeant Grunwald, yes, he was there.
He was present?
Correct.
Okay. And he was asking questions as well?
Yes.
Okay. And, okay. So you were working as a team?
Yes.
Okay. And you said he said some things, and then you believe he was being deceptive. I think you said that on direct examination. He was deceptive.
I said that, sir?
You were asked the question, was he being deceptive? You said yes.
I don't know if I said the word deceptive.
He didn't openly talk to you, did he?
He was speaking with me, but he wasn't communicating with regards to the situation.
You weren't satisfied with his answers.
That's correct.
Right? So you believe he was lying. You weren't satisfied with his answer. You came to get the truth, right?
Correct.
Right? So if you're not satisfied with his answers, you thought he was lying.
I thought he was withholding. I wouldn't call it lying, sir.
He was withholding. But you didn't know what, if anything, he knew at that point, did you?
Correct.
Right. So why would you think he was withholding of information when you say you just sat down and talked with him and you didn't really know what he knew, if anything, about what had occurred? So why would you think that he was withholding?
Based on my 13 years in law enforcement and approximately 8 years in investigations, I, based on body language and everything, I knew that there was more information there.
So you didn't have a basis for that conclusion. You were just assuming that he was withholding, correct?
Objection, Your Honor. I think his answer speaks for itself, but he's rephrasing.
Yeah.
Well, it's been asked and answered.
Okay,
so
yeah, I move forward. Thank you. Now, when he, in your opinion, failed to give you the information that you felt that he was in possession of, you threatened him, correct?
No, sir.
You told him that he can be a witness or he can be a suspect?
I don't believe I said that, or I don't recall saying that, sir.
And you were working in conjunction with the sergeant, correct?
My sergeant was present, correct, right. along with other officers.
And you don't recall asking him, Jalen, that he could tell the truth and help us solve a horrible crime, or he could lie to me and face the consequences? You don't recall telling him that?
I don't recall that, sir.
Do you recall your sergeant making that threat to Jalen?
He may have, but I don't recall
he
that.
He may
sir.
Have?
I don't recall.
When you say you don't recall, it could have happened and you can't remember?
Correct.
Why wouldn't you be able to remember? If you were sitting right there and you're focused on the same investigation, why couldn't you remember?
Sir, I deal with several cases. I
understand.
I don't remember everything.
I understand that, but you're there for the purpose of investigating a homicide, a horrific homicide, correct?
Correct.
Right? And you were there part of an investigation where there, I can't say interrogation, but you were trying to find out what had happened, correct?
Correct.
You were not satisfied with his answers, correct?
Correct.
And so you can't remember if your partner was threatening him that he can be a suspect or whether he can be a witness?
Correct. I don't recall that.
You don't recall that?
No, sir.
At some point, he began to tell you what had occurred. Is that correct?
I would say he gave us more information. Correct.
No, more information. As a matter of fact, he came right out the gate and said, Deshaun did it. He showed me the gun. He said, she shouldn't have grabbed my gun. Right? Isn't that what you testified to?
Yes.
How long into the interrogation did it take after you said that you believe he was being uncooperative before he came out with that story?
During the interview, I don't know the exact time, sir, within maybe 10, 15 minutes of speaking.
And his father's still sitting there, is that correct?
Correct.
You're taping this communication? Were you taping?
No, not at the home.
Why not? You had a cell phone, didn't you? You have a cell phone?
Yeah,
did
yes.
Did you have it in your possession at that time that you were interrogating?
My personal cell phone?
Yours, the department's phone?
Yeah.
We had the capacity to tape and record?
Yes.
You didn't tape them?
No.
Why not, sir?
From my knowledge, our personal cell phones don't have, I believe, evidentiary capability to record.
Okay. Now, he told you that Deshaun told him about a gun and that the complainant grabbed. Is that correct? That's what Jalen told you, correct?
Yes.
Why were you so quick to accept that as truth? If you believe he was just being deceptive to you, uncooperative, how did you confirm whether he was being truthful or whether he was lying again?
I believe I just took what he was telling me at the time as the truth, correct?
Yes, right. And you talked to him before you talked to this young man, Mr. Smith, right? You talked to Mr. Stringer first, then you talked to Mr. Smith, right?
When I initially first came into home, our contact was initially with Mr. Smith.
Okay. You talked to Mr. Stringer, correct?
And then after Mr. Stringer,
okay.
Correct, sir.
Okay. And Mr. Stringer told you what you're testifying here today, correct?
Yes.
And you didn't know if he was telling the truth or not, correct?
Who? I'm sorry, sir.
You didn't know if Mr. Stringer was telling the truth or not.
Initially, he was withholding. Honestly, he was lying to me.
Okay.
But then he...
He stopped lying? You're saying he stopped lying? Is that what you're testifying to?
Sir, you're saying that I said that he was lying. I said he was withholding. I believe they're two different things.
So he stopped being deceptive and stopped withholding?
Stopped withholding, yes.
How do you know? How do you know he stopped?
Just based on my experience, sir. So it's the best answer I can tell you.
So you're guessing?
I wouldn't say it's guessing, sir.
All right. So after he told you that this young man was, Mr. Smith was responsible, you were satisfied that he was being truthful, and you moved on with your investigation, correct?
My only part of the investigation was to speak to Mr. Stringer.
I understand that, sir. You moved on with your investigation, correct?
My portion of the investigation concluded at that point.
So you didn't have anything to do with the gun being found?
No, sir.
You weren't there when Mr. Stringer told, I'm assuming it was you, that he knew where the gun was located or he was able to find the gun in the house?
I was there when he had said that. I wasn't there when the gun was recovered.
Oh. You were there when Mr. Stringer told who where the gun was?
I believe he told, I was present and some other officers.
He's talking to you, right?
Correct.
Right? And he told you where the gun was?
Correct.
Right? And this is in the same context when you were asking him questions about what happened, correct?
Correct.
So after he told you where the gun, you got up and left?
No.
You didn't take his information and try to locate the gun?
No, my sole purpose was with Mr. Stringer.
I understand that. That's what we're talking about, Mr.
Yes.
Stringer. After he told you where the gun was, you didn't do anything about it?
Other officers may have, but I didn't. No, sir.
Okay. You didn't care? Who did you tell what he had told you in order for them to locate the gun, since you didn't locate it?
I believe at that point, when all that conversation had happened, we were back at the PD, and other officers were aware of the interview going on and had heard that information.
So you never told anybody what you said about the gun?
Sir, I was speaking to Mr. Stringer. I couldn't just leave and go tell other officers.
And you didn't know that he didn't tell you, he didn't lie to you about the different locations of where the gun was could be possibly found in the house?
There were two locations in the house where items were found.
I mean, we're talking about guns. The gun.
Correct.
So you say he never told you one location, then it wasn't there, then he told you another location? He didn't tell you that?
The first location was in his bedroom where the ammo was found. There was not a firearm located.
So he lied, right? He lied to you the location of that gun, didn't he?
There was no gun found,
sir. He told you the gun was in one location, didn't he? At first, you said a bedroom, right?
Yes, you said there was a backpack. Thought there was a gun in there in the vent. When we retrieved that, it was just ammunition.
He lied.
Objection, Your Honor. Ask and answer.
He won't answer. I just want to ask: he told you misinformation, misinformed you, lied to you?
Sir, yes, if he lied, if it's misinformation, lied, if he was mistaken, I don't know. I'm not in his mind.
Then he gave you a second location, correct?
There was a second location found, correct.
Mm-hmm. Gun wasn't there either, right?
I believe officers located a revolver that was in a second heating vent on the main
floor. You realize that there were two heating vents that were searched, correct? He told you about the first one, dropped the string and the gun, maybe down?
I was informed about two locations. One where the ammunition was found, I don't know anything about a string.
You didn't know anything?
The other location of near the Christmas tree.
Okay. Where was the gun ultimately located?
I believe the gun was located in the heating vent register on the main floor in the formal living room next to the Christmas tree, sir.
There were some bullets that were found, correct?
Correct.
Which heating vents were the bullets found in?
Your Honor, at this point, I'm going to object. I believe this officer testified that he was not present when these items were found.
Your Honor,
so it calls for hearsay in some sense, but if...
I don't know that it does. I mean, if he can answer, if the objection's overruled. Right. Let's move this along. Okay. It's been testified to.
Thank you, Anna. So, After you located the weapon, that's when Jalen was taken into custody?
I didn't locate the weapon, sir.
You weren't there when the weapon was located?
No, sir.
Okay. When did you leave the location?
You mean the home, sir? Mr. Stringer's home?
Yes.
Shortly after speaking to Jalen, we took him and drove him over to the police department where he said he wanted to speak with us, and then later went back to the home.
So you spoke with him later at the police department?
Yes.
Was his lawyer present then?
No.
So his lawyer may have been on the scene and never told you that he was there and never said, my client invokes his right not to talk?
No, I did not meet any attorney, sir.
Did you ever read Mr. Stringer, his Miranda rights saying that you don't have to talk to the police before we get started?
He was not in custody, sir.
I understand that, but at some point when he started giving you locations or possibly the location of the weapons, you never informed him that he has a right to remain silent?
He was not a suspect, sir.
Okay. But he's giving you information about the murder weapon, correct?
Correct.
Right. And you never informed him that he has a right to remain silent?
Sir, he was not a suspect. He was not in custody.
His lawyer never intervened?
Objection, Your Honor. Asked and answered. Well, that question.
His lawyer never intervened? Never intervened?
No.
Okay. And you never saw where the weapon was retrieved from?
No, I was not present, sir.
Okay. So if I told you in the vent next to the Christmas tree, you wouldn't know or not?
I was made aware of that's what was found, okay. But I wasn't present when it was okay. Retrieved.
No further questions.
Thank you. Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Your Honor. Detective, it's your testimony today that Jalen told you that Defendant Smith told him that he killed someone, and then Jalen washed his clothes and was involved in hiding the gun in the vent, and it's your testimony that Jalen could have walked out that door.
If you could rephrase, there's several questions in there.
I think it's a number of events and then one question. My question is, after Jalen told you that Defendant Smith told him that Defendant Smith killed someone.
Correct.
And then Jalen, according to you, washed Defendant Smith's clothes.
Correct.
Was somehow involved in the gun in the vent. So
okay.
You knew all that. After hearing all that, Jalen was free to walk out that door.
Jalen left on his own that day, correct.
When you started the interview with him, you would have been going around with what words you've used. What I wrote down was, you said he wasn't so forthcoming with the information he knew. And you concluded that because of one of the things you used was his mannerisms.
Correct.
That's
my
the word
experience,
you used.
Yes.
What were those mannerisms?
Just based upon my years of experience, his willingness not to talk to me, I could tell he was very nervous. And I could tell that James's father was just informing him that he should be, if he knows any information, to tell us.
I understand that. I didn't hear in there a mannerism. What was a mannerism that he exhibited that led you to believe that he wasn't being forthcoming?
I don't recall the exact mannerisms, but there were several.
Did you write him in the report?
No.
Did you write the word mannerisms in your report?
No.
You also used the words body language. What was the body language that he exhibited?
Jalen kept, shifting in his chair, wiping his palms on his jeans, just the normal, signs that we're trained to look for when speaking with people.
Normal signs when they're 6 or 8 police personnel in your house?
I don't know how many officers were in the house, but I mean, I guess anybody would be nervous if law enforcement was in their home.
I agree. You also testified that he told you that Jalen told you that Defendant Smith left after 45 minutes into a Madden football game and returned 45 minutes after he left. Is that accurate?
That's correct.
And you spoke earlier in your testimony in generalities about the clothes and the washer. Who asked the question about the clothes? What was the first mention of clothes?
I don't even know, sir, when who mentioned. I know that I don't believe I said it. I believe that was said with regards to the other officers that were currently present in the kitchen.
So it was said while you were in the kitchen?
Yes.
Okay. But you don't recall who said it?
No.
Or exactly what they said?
No.
And did anyone ask when he washed the clothes?
No, I don't recall a current time frame that was spoken about.
So whether it's a time of day or a time in relation to an event, you don't know under either of those measures of time, you don't know when the clothes were washed.
Not the exact time, no, I don't know, sir.
Do you know an approximate time?
No, I don't know an approximate time.
It's my understanding that while you were speaking with Jalen, and he was, there was mention of, you thought it unusual that someone would wash Defendant Smith's clothes for him. Do you recall saying something like that during this time period?
I don't recall saying something like that, sir.
Are you saying you didn't say it, or you don't recall?
I don't recall.
If you had known that, or if you know now, that when Defendant Smith would visit Jalen from time to time in the past, he would wash his clothes, would that put a different light on it happening this time? Would that make it more normal?
It would be in the norm, correct, if that happened on previous occasions.
Okay. Did you see what Defendant Smith was wearing when you came in? You talked to Defendant Smith first, right?
Yes, that night, yes.
And you saw what he was wearing?
Correct.
And you said a tank top?
Yes.
And you said a couple of pairs of shorts?
Correct, like basketball shorts.
Okay. Do you know what was in the pockets of those shorts?
I believe I was...
He
was after.
What he believed, whether he knows or he's guessing, it's speculation.
It's a statement.
Do you know what was in the pockets of the shorts?
Yes.
What was in the pocket?
He was being searched due to an outstanding warrant that he had, and there was a pair of, I believe it was like latex gloves that were found in one of the short pockets.
And what color were the latex gloves?
Black.
I'm not offering this to show that they're the gloves. I'm just offering for the color. Is this the color?
Yes.
Okay. Was Detective Case there at the time his clothes were searched?
Detective Case was in the house. I don't know if he was present where Mr. Smith was being searched.
Okay. Who was present?
I was present, and I believe Sergeant Grunewald was there present.
Did you ever see the gloves on Defendant Smith?
On his hands, sir?
Yes.
No, sir.
They're just in the pockets.
Correct.
Would you say that depending on the lighting conditions at the time, if Defendant Smith was wearing gloves of that color, it might be difficult to detect that he was wearing those gloves? Not while you were searching him, not while the police was there, but police were there, but in a more less intense time than the house full of police. If the lighting was such, would it be possible for Defendant Smith to be wearing those gloves and someone might not detect that he is?
Objection against acts of speculation.
He's had 13 years of experience. He can tell what people are thinking by their mannerisms.
Sustained, if you can show the foundation, please, counsel.
In your 13 years of experience, have you had occasion to investigate or be involved in situations where people were wearing clothing that other people couldn't detect, depending on the light, how far away?
Correct.
Based on that?
Objection, Your Honor. Relevance in terms of what is done, he's done in his experience.
Well, if he's allowed to rely on his 13 years of experience to say what mannerisms mean, am I not allowed to inquire, based on those 13 years of experience, whether someone might be wearing something that is not detectable?
It's the form of the question, I think, that's problematic. You could certainly ask in a different way. I don't know if you're going to get an objection, but go ahead.
In the course of your 13 years as a police officer and detective, have you seen someone wearing clothes that were not, may not have been detectable to other people involved in the case?
Again, Your Honor, relevance, lack of foundation.
Sustained. I'm sustaining it. Let's move on.
When you were in the kitchen talking to Jalen and other people in the kitchen.
Yes.
Jalen's father, Mr. Stringer, was in there at the beginning.
Correct.
Didn't there come a time when he left the room and was talking to other people in other rooms?
He may have been in and out. I don't recall that. Okay.
And there were conversations going on in other rooms.
Correct.
Near the kitchen.
Yes.
Do you recall saying to Jalen that you thought he looked distracted?
I don't recall saying that.
Do you recall saying to him or noticing yourself that it appeared that he was trying to hear conversations that were going on in other rooms?
Yes.
You testified it was about 15 minutes from the time you started questioning him until he became forthcoming with his answers.
Approximately, okay. Yes, sir.
And once he became forthcoming, he said it all right at once. You didn't have to drag it out of him over another 15 or 30 or an hour. Is that correct?
Correct. Okay.
Were you aware of a circumstance that occurred simultaneously with Jalen becoming forthcoming? Did something happen right at the time he started telling you things?
No, sir, I don't recall that.
Wasn't Defendant Smith taken out of the room and out of the house at that time?
I don't know when Mr. Smith was taken out of the home, relative to when I was speaking to Jalen.
But it was when you were in the kitchen, is that correct?
Yes.
And would it surprise you, or would you disagree, if others would say.
I don't even know if that is a good surprise.
Why don't you let him finish the question, please? Thank you.
You said you're not sure if an event, Defendant Smith being taken, you're not sure if that happened at the time. If others said it, that it did happen at that time, would you disagree with them?
Objection, I ain't asking them to speculate.
He said he's not sure, and I'm asking...
Well, others?
Is he very not sure?
Repeat the question, counsel, please.
You testified that you weren't sure if Jalen becoming forthcoming occurred when Defendant Smith was taken from the room. You said you're not sure.
Correct.
You're not saying it didn't happen, you're not saying it did, you're saying you're not sure.
Correct.
If others said that it happened simultaneously, would you disagree with them?
Objection, Your Honor. If others, he's asking them to speak as to what someone else's state of mind is, he's not even in a position or lack of foundation.
I'm not asking their state of mind. I'm asking if they said that. Would that be a surprise, or would that...
Don't seem to involve your state of mind.
Okay. But while you were in the kitchen questioning him, Defendant Smith was taken out. You testified to that?
Correct. Okay.
Yeah,
just for the record, that's not what he testified to. He testified he didn't know when he left.
You know what? I'm taking notes, and we're all taking our own notes, and he's asking the questions right now. So go ahead.
Based on your 13 years of experience, if Jalen had been threatened by Defendant Smith...
Objection, Your Honor. Facts not in evidence. I don't know where that came from.
You're going to let him finish the question, okay?
Suggesting that he threatened him.
Let's let him finish the question.
Based on your 13 years of experience, if might Defendant Smith leaving, being taken from the premises, be a cause for Jalen to become forthcoming at that time?
Sustained.
Have you ever dealt with witnesses, which Jalen was at the time, being threatened?
You've got to hear the question.
Have you ever dealt with witnesses who have been threatened?
Relevant.
Well, I'm going to get to that, depending on his answer.
Well, why don't you give me a hint?
how would you like me to give you that hint, Your Honor?
Lack of foundation.
I'm asking you if he's ever...
I don't know that it's relevant.
Okay.
I really don't find it to be relevant. We're talking about this case today, mm-hmm. not his past dealings, so the objection is sustained.
Okay. Do you know of any threats made in this case?
I have not known of any threats made in this case, no, sir.
You're aware that Jalen and Defendant Smith grew up together for a time in Detroit?
Correct.
Are you aware of any other family members of Defendant Smith who grew up in that same area and the two of them associated with, at that time or later?
No, I'm not aware of any of that, sir.
Who did Jalen say that he was it you that Jalen said he wanted to go to the police station?
Yes.
Okay. Was anybody else present when he said that?
I believe there's other officers present.
How did you transport him? Whose car?
He was taken in my work surveillance vehicle.
Is it a van?
Yes.
And you were in the driver's seat?
Correct.
And your was it your partner in the back seat with
Lieutenant? Yes, in the third row.
Okay. What's your partner's name?
Detective Tash.
Okay. Was there any conversation during the trip down there to the police station?
Yes.
Who said what? What did you say something?
Yeah, I know there was dialogue back and forth, but I don't know exactly what was said.
Was it chit-chat about the Lions, or was it about the case, or?
I think it was probably a little bit of both, a little bit of okay. Just.
What did you talk about the case?
I don't recall exactly.
Did your partner talk about the case also?
He had interjected into the conversation, but I don't know what he had said.
And did he fill out a report?
I don't know.
But you fill out a report, and there's nothing in it about any conversation that happened on the way to the police station?
No, sir.
No more questions, Your Honor.
Thank you, Ms. Collins. Discreetly, I believe. Well, I don't think there's anything that's going to be brief, because if you have relevant questions that have been not been asked, go ahead, because once you start, I have to do another recross. So it's 12:30 and you have many more witnesses, am I correct?
I have one more witness after this.
That's it, just one more?
Yes.
How many questions do you have for redirect?
You know what? As the court said, we've all been taking notes. I'll just... I believe I have good enough notes from what you said before.
All right, thank you very much. Detective, you may step down.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you. Call your next witness, please.
People call Detective Case to the stand.
Detective, if you could raise your right hand, please. Do you solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you're about to provide is the truth, so help me God?
I do.
Thank you. Please be seated.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Could you please state your full name and spell both your first and last name for the record?
Detective Derek Case, DerekKase.
And Detective, where are you employed?
West Bloomfield Police Department.
Are you the detective that's been assigned to this case?
I am.
Okay. Were you the on-call detective back on December 9th of 2016?
I was.
At that time, how long had you been in law enforcement?
At that time, around 8.5 years.
Okay. And as the on-call detective, were you called in from home and given information about why you were being called in?
Yes.
Okay. That information, was that relayed to you from other investigators who were on scene initially?
It was initially relayed to me by a dispatcher, and then thereafter, once I arrived at the station, further information was given to me.
Okay. Now, as part of the normal protocol or the normal procedure, when you arrive at the station, are you what we call briefed on information that has been obtained thus far in the investigation?
Yes.
Okay. And so is there throughout the investigation an attempt for an exchange of information as information is gleaned from different areas or different people?
Absolutely.
Okay. Am I to assume that you know every single thing at the moment that is learned by any other officer?
No, not at all.
But at some point, your expectation would be that you would be advised or be updated or briefed on anything new that has happened or that has been found out?
Correct.
Okay. So when you're first called in, do you recall what time you were called at home?
Approximately 2 a.m.
Okay. And you said that you proceeded to the station first?
Yes.
You were provided information about, at least to your knowledge, what was known at that point?
Yes.
What information did you have?
On the way in, I was told there was a vehicle fire and there was something inside of the vehicle.
Okay. Once you got to the police department, did you learn anything new?
Yes, I learned it was a body that was inside of the vehicle.
Okay. Were you also provided any other information about things that were being observed or done at the scene or other scenes of interest, I'll call them?
Yes.
Okay. Were those all related to the Shorecrest area, Westover area, Wimberley Court area, all of those areas that you've heard talked about during the course of this preliminary examination?
Yes, other than when I initially went out to the owner of the vehicle's residence, which was in Farmington Hills.
Okay, okay. And was that a Mr. Richard Pissarol?
Correct.
Okay. Did you have an occasion at some point during this investigation on December 9th, 2016, to visit, and I'm going to go through the locations, but to visit the Pine Lake Elementary area?
Yes.
And where the car fire and the body was located?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Did you have an opportunity to go out and visit Wimberley Court area?
Later on in the morning.
Okay. Did you have an opportunity or were you apprised of information provided by a Quinn Kyriakis?
I was later on.
Okay. Were you provided any information? Did you have an opportunity to go out to what we've been referring to as the Orchard Lake boat launch?
Yes, that morning.
Did you also have an opportunity to go out to the location where the victim, Diana Pissarol, resided over on Westover?
I don't believe that morning I did go over there, no.
Okay. Not that morning? Did you go over there?
Eventually I did, yes.
Okay. Now, were you provided information about shoe prints or footwear impressions that other officers had been bringing you up to speed about what they observed?
Yes.
Okay. When you went out to these locations, and I'll talk to you first about the Pine Lake Elementary, were you apprised of tire tracks that were of note and shoe prints that were of note, things like that?
I was told there was being evidence collected regarding shoe prints and tire impressions.
When you went out to the location at Pine Lake Elementary, did you also, with your eyes, observe tire tracks that were referenced and footwear impressions that were referenced?
From a distance, yes.
Okay. How about over at Wimberley Court? When you visited Wimberley Court, had you been apprised of tire tracks?
I was aware there had been tire tracks at Wimberley Court, but they had disintegrated by the time I arrived there.
How about the fluid trail that had been mentioned?
Yes, I actually discovered the fluid trail that was there.
And how about you were apprised or knew about the area of the wooden barricade?
Yes.
Did you have an opportunity to observe that?
I did.
And that was damaged in some way?
Correct.
Do you have an opportunity to observe a plastic piece that appeared to have come from a vehicle?
I did.
Did you have an opportunity to observe footwear impressions or shoe prints at the Wimberley Court area?
No.
Okay. How about over, you said at Westover Court, were you present? Were you able to locate any footwear impressions when you were there, or tire tracks or fluid trails, things like that? Okay. And how about over at Shorecrest at Mr. Stringer's home? Are you familiar with that location?
I am familiar with the location.
Did you follow any fluid trails or observe any fluid trails or tire tracks or shoe prints over there?
I did not.
Okay. Now, are you familiar with the shoe prints that we've been speaking about that have been described thus far in the preliminary examination? You indicated that, I apologize. Let me ask you this, if I may approach.
Sure.
I'm showing you what's been marked as People's Proposed Exhibit Number 11. I'd ask you to take a look at that and tell me if you recognize
it.
Yes, this is one of the photographs we went over. Showing you what's been marked as People's Proposed Exhibit Number 11. I'd ask you to take a look at that and tell me if you recognize what area is shown.
I do.
And what area is shown in that photograph?
That is the area of the playground and basketball courts behind Pine Lake Elementary at 3333 Long Lake Road.
Okay. Does that photograph also reveal or show where the car was located that had been burned?
Yes.
And where the body was ultimately found?
Correct.
Okay. With regard, is that an accurate reflection of what that location looked like on December 9th, 2016, after the fire had been extinguished and the body had been removed?
Yes.
Okay. Now, I note that in the photograph there are two plastic pieces. What are those on top of? Is it grassy area? Is it a pathway? What is that on top of?
It is a concrete sidewalk.
Okay, so when we've been talking about the pathway is that the pathway that is in that area that leads from the playground area and behind the school down to the residential areas?
Yes, at least toward the residential area. I'm not positive it goes all the way to the residential area because it was snowy when I had gone out to the scene.
Okay. And with regard to those plastic pieces that are shown in the picture, do you have any information as to what those were?
Yes, I was aware that they were placed over foot impressions by Sergeant Wessel, I believe.
Excuse me, sir, can you speak up, please?
Yes, I'm aware that they were placed over foot impressions found at the scene by investigators.
Your Honor, at this time, people move to admit people's proposed exhibit number 11.
No objection for the examination.
Okay. No objection, Your Honor.
May I publish to the court?
Sure.
Thank you. As the officer in charge of this case, have you been provided with the photographs and the evidence that has been collected in this case?
I have.
Have you had an opportunity to review those photographs?
I have.
Specifically, have you had an opportunity to review photographs of the shoe print or the shoe impressions that were taken at several different areas?
Yes, many of them.
I know that you mentioned that there were shoe impressions at several different locations. The photographs that you've been able to review, as well as the ones that you made personal observations from, are they all similar in nature?
All except for one pair of shoes at the boat launch.
Okay. With regard to the shoes that are similar, so the one pair or the one set of shoe prints that was at, do I understand correctly that you reviewed two sets of shoe prints that are at the boat area?
Correct.
Okay, so one of them
is consistent with the other areas.
Okay, and one of them you were only familiar with from the boat launch?
Correct.
Area. Okay, just so I understand correctly. Showing you now what's been marked as people's proposed exhibit number 12. They ask you to take a look at that photograph and tell me if you've seen that photograph before.
I have.
Now, is it fair to say that you can't tell me which particular location that photograph was taken?
That is fair.
Okay. But do you recognize that shoe print impression?
Can I object?
Absolutely.
Unless you lay a proper foundation, John, this is he recognized the shoe.
Well, right now, she's not finished, first of all, so she's going to have to lay a proper foundation. But the question was if he recognizes the area, was that it?
No, if he recognizes the shoe impression that is shown in that photograph.
Okay, there's nothing improper about that. Objections overruled. Go ahead.
Thank you. Where have you seen that shoe impression before?
I have seen it in multiple photographs from different locations along the crime scene.
Okay, when you're talking about different locations along the crime scene, are you talking about, and I know I keep pointing, I apologize, you're familiar with what's already been admitted as People's Exhibit Number 7, the map of the area? So when you're talking about along the crime scene, are you talking about just one location in particular, or are you talking about several different locations?
Multiple locations.
Okay, can you tell me what locations you recall?
Sure. Photos taken at Pine Lake, behind Pine Lake Elementary, from just west of Pine Lake Elementary over on Wimberley, from the area in front of 4138 Westover, and from the boat launch on Orchard Lake Road.
And 4138 Westover, that was Diana Pesserol's, was that her residence?
That's correct.
Okay. Showing you what's been marked as People's Proposed Exhibit Number 13. I guess, do you recognize the shoe print that is shown in that photograph?
Yes.
Okay. Now, again, is it fair to say that you can't tell me where, which particular location that photograph was taken?
That's correct.
But do you recognize the shoe print that is revealed in that photograph?
Yes.
And where is it familiar to you from?
From this previous photograph, as well as the same locations I just illustrated to you.
Okay, behind Pine Lake Elementary. So that, when we're talking about the shoe print, and its particular square heel and things like that, that's what you're referring to?
Now she's giving particular square heel, so she's testifying.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, so that shoe print itself, or the nature of that shoe print is something that you have seen before?
Yes.
Okay. Your Honor, at this time, people move to admit people's proposed exhibit number 12 and 13.
Any objection, Mr. Robbins, first?
Not on behalf of Mr. Smith for the exam.
Okay, Mr. Smith.
No objection.
All right, they're received.
Thank you. May I publish?
Yes.
Thank you. Detective Case, were you at some point present at Jalen Stringer's home when Detective Kassab and I believe Detective Tash and perhaps and James Stringer were present in the kitchen of that home?
Yes.
Can you recall if when you arrived, and I want to be very specific, when you arrived into the kitchen, mm-hmm. do you recall if there was anybody else there besides, who was there?
Detective Kassab, Detective Tash, myself, I believe Detective Mullick was in the area, Jalen Stringer, and I believe James Stringer was in and out of the area at times.
Okay. Is it fair to say that you were not, were you present for the entire interaction between Jalen Stringer and whomever else was in that kitchen?
No, not the entire deal. No.
Okay. When you came into the kitchen, was there a discussion going on?
Yes.
Okay. And can you tell me what portion of that discussion you heard?
Objection, hearsay, Your Honor, a more specific question.
Well,
just randomly talking about what discussion, Your Honor?
Sustained.
Let me ask you this. When you came upon the kitchen area, did you hear Jalen Stringer speaking?
Yes.
What specifically did you hear Jalen Stringer say?
He stated that he had washed Deshaun Smith's clothes after they arrived home from the 7-Eleven.
Okay. Now, at that point, up until that point, did you have any information about any trip to 7-Eleven?
Yes.
Okay. So, now, where had you learned that information from? From other law enforcement or from someone else?
At that point, it was at it was from other law enforcement.
Okay. But so 7-Eleven or a trip to 7-Eleven was not something outside of your knowledge base at that point, or information base, I should say.
I apologize. Let me go back. I had stopped at 7-Eleven briefly prior to that and spoken with the clerk.
And why had you stopped at 7-Eleven to speak with the clerk?
Because I had received information that Jalen Stringer may have been at that 7-Eleven prior to him being stopped by Officer Daly.
Okay. So when you walked into the kitchen, you heard Jalen Stringer say that he had washed. Tell me again.
Jalen Stringer stated he had washed.
Well, Your Honor, I'm just trying to make sure I get the timeline down because I know what's coming
asking
across.
The time, but again, ask and answer.
It's been asked and answered. Sustain.
After you heard Jalen Stringer say that he had washed Deshaun Smith's clothing after coming back from 7-Eleven, what did you do?
I was directly next to the washroom, so I walked over to the washing machine and lifted the lid to it.
Okay. And did you make any observations about what was in the washing machine?
Yes.
What did you observe? Did you touch anything in the washing machine?
No.
Okay. What did you observe in the washing machine?
I observed some black-colored damp clothing and I believe a blanket.
Okay.
I'm sorry, what was the last thing you said?
A blanket.
You mentioned that prior to going over to the Stringer home, you had stopped at the 7-Eleven and spoken with the clerk.
Correct.
At that point, were you given an opportunity to review any type of surveillance video from the 7-Eleven?
Not at that point, no.
Were you at some point?
Yes.
And when was that in relation to being at the Stringer home and observing what Jalen Stringer said and then looking in the laundry room?
Maybe an hour after or so.
Okay. Had you, at some point during this investigation, were you provided with any information about a trip to Qdoba?
Yes.
Was that before or after you were at the Stringer home and heard Jalen Stringer talk about the clothing and 7-Eleven?
Was I provided that information? I learned the information after.
After, okay. Did you have an opportunity at some point to go to Qdoba and review video surveillance?
I did not go to Qdoba myself, but I did review this video surveillance collected by another officer.
Okay, okay. And your review of that surveillance evidence, was that before or after you were in the Stringer home in the kitchen?
That was after.
This interaction took place. Okay. Let me talk to you about the Qdoba surveillance video. You had an opportunity to review that?
Yes.
Is it time-stamped?
Yes.
So based on your viewing of it, does it indicate what time of day and what date, the portion that you were reviewing revealed?
Yes.
What date and time frame?
It was on December 8th of 2017, sometime after 8 p.m. I'd have to refer to my report to get an exact time.
Okay. Would taking a look at your report help refresh your recollection?
Yes.
Okay. If you would take a look at that report and then let me know when you finish reviewing it. Sure. But you also indicated December 8th of 2017?
16, I'm sorry.
Okay.
I apologize, that information is not in my report.
Okay.
I am just positive it's sometime between 8 and 8:45 p.m. on the 8th of December, 2016.
Okay. And when reviewing that video, did you take any note of the, did you see Jalen Stringer in the surveillance video from the Qdoba?
Yes.
Did you see Deshaun Smith?
I did.
Now, are you familiar with Jalen Stringer and Deshaun Smith?
I am.
Okay. Do you see both of them in the courtroom today?
I do.
Okay. Could you point to Jalen Stringer and describe something that he's wearing today?
He is the gentleman to my left seated second from the left at the defense table wearing a orange jumpsuit.
Okay. Your Honor, may the record reflect that the witness has identified the defendant in this matter, Jalen Stringer?
Yes.
And do you see Deshaun Smith in the
court? I do.
Could you point to him and describe something that he's wearing today?
He is at the far left end of the table, furthest from me, wearing the same colored jumpsuit.
Your Honor, may the record reflect that the witness has identified that defendant, Deshaun Smith?
Yes.
Were you able to take note of any footwear color that the two gentlemen were wearing in the Qdoba video?
The colors, yes.
Yes, okay. So what color shoes was Jalen Stringer wearing in the Qdoba video?
Blue.
Okay. And how about Deshaun Smith?
Black.
Now, when you had an opportunity to review the 7-Eleven surveillance video, do you see either Jalen Stringer or Deshaun Smith in that 7-Eleven video?
Yes, Jalen Stringer.
Okay. And are you able to take note of the color of the footwear that Jalen Stringer is wearing at 7-Eleven?
Yes.
Do you know what time that is?
Beginning at 1:44 a.m. and ending at 1:48 a.m. on December 9th, 2016.
Okay. And what color footwear is Jalen Stringer wearing?
Blue.
Are you familiar, was the clothing from the washing machine that you had seen, were the items seized as a result of a search conducted at the Stringer home after you had looked in the laundry room?
They were.
Okay. Was that conducted, were you present when that search was conducted?
The very tail end of it, I stopped by, but I was not there. I did not actively conduct any searching myself.
Okay. And are you familiar with whether or not a jacket was retrieved or seized from that washing machine?
Yes.
And was one?
Yes.
Do you know what color it was?
Black.
Texion, I don't know if he's relying, because he testified that he didn't personally, so he's relying on hearsay, if that's what he's testifying to.
Well, you can ask it on cross. Go ahead, next question.
Thank you. You did not place Deshaun Smith under arrest, correct?
Correct.
Okay. But were you aware that he had been placed under arrest?
Yes.
Okay. And directing your attention to December 11th of 2016, were you called out to speak with him as a result of something?
Yes.
And why were you called out?
I was at the station finishing up on some paperwork. I was approached by Sergeant Spencer, who notified me that Deshaun Smith from his jail cell had asked Sergeant Spencer during a prisoner check that he wished to speak with someone about his case.
Okay. Did you respond and meet with Deshaun Smith?
I did.
Okay. And did you speak to him about his right to remain silent?
I did.
Did you advise him of what we commonly refer to as his Miranda rights?
I did.
Tell him he had a right to remain silent and not to talk to you. Anything he said could be used against him. He had a right to speak with a lawyer. All of the prerequisites to having a conversation with him?
That's correct.
What did Mr. Smith indicate to you about his desire or lack thereof to speak with you?
That he wished to waive his rights and speak with me without an attorney present.
And did you speak with him?
I did, myself and Lieutenant Roy.
Okay. Did you talk with him about the events on December 8th of 2016 leading up into the early morning hours of December 9th of 2016?
I did.
And did Mr. Smith indicate to you anything about where he was?
Yes.
What did he tell you?
He told me that he had come from a taxi cab. He had gotten a taxi cab from Northland, near Northland Mall, up to Jalen Stringer's house. He said he had met with Jalen Stringer and his family for a short period of time before they went to Qdoba and Wendy's to get food. He stated that they then returned to Jalen Stringer's house. Shortly thereafter, Deshaun went on his own to the Kroger at Lone Pine and Orchard Lake Road. After getting lost in the subdivision, returned to the Shorecrest address before going to the 7-Eleven at Orchard Lake Road in Lone Pine, where shortly thereafter they went to the boat launch at Orchard Lake Road and Pontiac Trail, and then returned home again to the Shorecrest address before being met by police officers several hours later.
Okay. So let me back up a little bit. He talked to you, you said, about a cab and arriving at Jalen Stringer's home.
Yes.
When he spoke to you about going to Qdoba and Wendy's, did he indicate who went to Qdoba and Wendy's?
Yes.
Who went?
He and Jalen.
Okay, according to Mr. Smith.
Correct.
Okay. And at some point, was it before or after speaking with Mr. Smith that you had an opportunity to review the surveillance video of Qdoba?
After.
Okay. And when he spoke to you about going to Kroger, did he indicate to you whether anybody else was with him?
Yes.
And what did he say?
No.
Nobody else was with him?
Correct.
Okay. When he spoke to you about 7-Eleven and the boat launch, did he indicate whether he was with anybody at those two locations?
Yes.
Who did he indicate he was with?
Jalen.
Okay, Jalen Stringer?
Correct.
You indicated that Deshaun Smith talked to you about getting lost in the subdivision. Did he talk to you about any specifics that he claims to remember about his trip back
Yes.
to the Stringer home? What did he tell you?
He stated that he had been up at Kroger sitting outside of the building, if I may use the map.
If the map would assist you, yes.
Yeah.
Where would that have been?
Yeah, he stated he was sitting on the bench area outside of the Kroger at Orchard Lake and Lone Pine, which is right here. He stated on his way back, he made the second left into the subdivision, which he knew was the way to get back to Jalen Stringer's house. He stated he became lost and ran into three people who were standing in a driveway and asked if they knew where Shorecrest Circle was.
Now, did he talk about people standing in a driveway, in a garage, where specifically, or if he was specific?
He said in the driveway.
Okay. And did he indicate whether these people were male or female?
It was one female and two males.
Okay. Did he indicate what street?
He was not aware of the actual street, no.
Okay. Did what did he tell you about any interaction that he had with these three individuals?
He asked if they knew where Shorecrest was, and one of the individuals replied, "Are you looking for..."
Objection, you say?
Your Honor, I'm not offering for the truth of the matter asserted. I'm offering it to show what Mr. Smith indicated to Detective Case.
Sustained. Here's the objection, sustained.
Without telling us what Mr. Smith told you the person said, did he indicate what he did next?
Yes, he stated he left the house, made a left turn, began walking toward Shorecrest, became confused again and turned back the way he came. He stated he then looked to his left and noticed a vehicle with the dome light on in the driveway several houses down to that street.
Now, are you familiar with the area that is shown on that map?
I am.
And the areas that are highlighted?
Yes.
With regard, are you familiar with a witness by the name of Quinn Kyriakos?
I am.
Did you have an opportunity to speak with her and find out what, if any, information she had?
Yes.
Or no, okay. Are you familiar with what street she lives on?
Yes.
What street is that?
Ivernus.
Okay, and if can you point to on that map where Ivernus is?
Here.
And is that where that small highlight is?
Yes.
Okay. Now, you indicated that Deshaun indicated he continued down that street, took a left, and did he indicate to you what the next direction he was supposed to go in?
Another left at the next street.
Okay. Did he indicate to you whether he took that left?
Yes.
And what did he say about taking that left or not?
He did not make that left because he believes he passed the street.
So what street would that have been from Ivernus if he took a left off of Ivernus?
McNichol.
Okay. And is the next left a particular street?
Yes.
What street is that?
Shorecrest.
Okay. But Mr. Smith said he did not go down Shorecrest at that time?
Correct.
When you say he turned back around and then turned left, is there a street that is there to his left?
Yes.
What street would that be?
Westover.
And who lives on that street?
Diana and Marina Pesser.
Okay. What, if anything, did Deshaun Smith indicate about what he did once he saw this car that had a light on?
He stated that he approached the residence, began going to the house to knock on the door, and then his attention was caught by a female inside of that vehicle.
Okay. Did he indicate to you what type of clothing he was wearing on his torso area during his jaunt to Kroger?
He said he had a hoodie on because it was cold outside.
Okay. Did he indicate whether or not he had any interaction with the woman in the car?
Yes.
And did he indicate whether or not he got directions from that person?
Yes.
And did he indicate what he did after he got directions from that person?
Yes.
What did he indicate?
He stated he asked the female for a cigarette, retrieved a cigarette from that female, and then followed her directions.
The person, the female that Mr. Smith describes, he give a description of a female?
Yes.
And does he give a description that matches Diana Pesserl?
No.
Do you talk to him specifically about Diana Pesserl?
Yes.
And does he acknowledge seeing her or denying?
Denies.
During your conversation with Mr. Smith, do you talk to him about whether or not he owns Prada shoes?
Yes.
And what does he say about Prada shoes and whether or not he owns them?
He says he does own a pair.
Did you talk to him about Prada shoe prints being located near Diana Pesserl's driveway or in Diana Pesserl's driveway?
Yes.
And what is his response?
Everyone in West Bloomfield owns Pradas.
Are you familiar with the Pradas that were seized from the Stringer's home?
I am.
When you speak with Mr. Smith, does he indicate where the last place that he left his Pradas were?
Yes.
And where was that?
That was at Jalen Stringer's residence.
Have you had an opportunity to observe and review the Pradas that were taken from the Stringer home?
Yes.
Now, let me ask you this. Were those Pradas going back to when you were in the kitchen and you were observing some of the interaction between Detective Kassab and Jalen Stringer? Were these shoes taken at that time or sometime later? When?
No, they were brought back to the station maybe 8-9 hours later.
Okay. Showing you what's been marked as People's Proposed Exhibit number 14, I'd ask you to take a look at that photograph and tell me if you recognize what is shown.
I do.
What is shown in that photograph?
That is a photo of the Prada shoes I observed back at the police station after the execution of the search warrant at 4031 Shorecrest.
Okay. And do those accurately reflect the status of the Prada shoes when they were taken into evidence and you observed them?
It does.
Okay. Showing you now what's been marked as People's Proposed Exhibit number 15, I'd ask you to take a look at that photograph and tell me if you recognize what is shown there.
Yes.
What is shown in that photograph?
The bottom of the same pair of shoes.
Okay. And can you tell if that's the right or the left shoe?
Looks like it would be the right shoe.
Okay. And did you have an opportunity to take a look at the treads on the bottom of these Prada shoes?
I did.
Do those accurately reflect the treads on the bottom of the Prada shoes that are in evidence at the West Bloomfield Police Department or now at the Michigan State Police Crime Lab?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I'm showing you what's been marked as People's Proposed Exhibit number 16. I'd ask you to take a look at that photograph and tell me if you recognize what is shown there.
Yes.
What does that show?
The bottom of the left shoe of the same set of shoes.
And does that accurately reflect what the bottom of the left shoe looked like when you observed those shoes?
Yes, ma'am.
And lastly, showing you what's been marked as People's Proposed Exhibit number 17, I'd ask you to take a look at that photograph and tell me if you recognize what is shown there.
I do.
What is shown in that photograph?
That is a close-up of the heel of the left shoe of the Prada pair of shoes that I have observed in the last two pictures.
And does that accurately reflect the bottom of that portion of the shoe?
Yes.
Your Honor, at this time, the people move to admit People's Proposed Exhibits 14, 15, 16, and 17.
No objection. Yeah, Mr. Smith, for purpose of exam.
Okay. No objection.
And may I publish them, Your Honor? Thank you. Let me ask you this. You talked about some blue shoes. Were some blue Nikes also seized from the Stringer home?
I'm not sure if they were taken from the home or from Jalen Stringer's person. I know a pair of blue Nikes were seized, though.
Okay. Are you familiar with the treads with regard to the bottom of the blue Nikes?
I am familiar with them, yes.
And Can you tell whether they are similar or the same as those of the promise?
They are not.
Proper foundation, so I actually speculate.
You can't build a foundation.
Have you had an opportunity to look at the treads of the bottom of the Nikes?
Yes.
And you've observed the bottom of the treads on the Pradas?
Correct.
Are they similar in nature?
No.
You mentioned that during the course of your conversation with Mr. Smith, he gave you a different description of the female that he interacted with at the car.
Correct.
As part of this investigation, was there a canvas and anything done with regard to the surrounding neighborhood?
Yes.
What was done in relation to reaching out to people who live in that area and in this subdivision?
Multiple detectives took a printed form that we had completed stating that a homicide had taken place in the neighborhood, and anyone with any form of any information or contacts with a suspicious person or incident to call the West Bloomfield Police Department to speak with us.
And was that form letter placed at every location in the subdivision? Can you kind of give us an idea of where it was fanned out to?
Yeah, the general areas around where these yellow highlighted homes are.
Okay. Would it have included Westover?
Yes.
Would it have included Iverness?
Yes.
Would it have included Shorecrest?
Yes.
Would it have included Wimberley?
Yes.
Okay. And as well as other streets that may not have been testified about in this preliminary examination thus far?
Yes.
Okay. Have you, and as the officer in charge, any information that would have come into the West Bloomfield Police Department, would that have been relayed or referred over to you?
Yes.
Okay. Have you had any interaction or any notice from any person indicating interaction other than what we've talked about here, for instance, Quinn Kuriakis? Specifically what I'm asking, I guess, is has anyone come forward and talked to you about having an interaction while being at or near their car in front of their home?
No.
I know that you indicated that when you watch the 7-Eleven video, you only see Mr. Stringer, Jalen Stringer, on that video. When you were speaking with Mr. Smith, Deshaun Smith, did he indicate whether or not he accompanied Mr. Stringer to the 7-Eleven?
Yes.
And what did he say about that?
He said he did.
Okay. With regard to the boat launch and the interaction with Officer Daly, did Mr. Smith indicate whether or not he was there?
Yes.
And what did he say?
He was.
I have no further questions at this time, Your Honor.
All right, thank you. Counsel, before we begin, I'm going to take a brief break here. Detective, if you could step down.
Appreciate it.
And detectives, our officers, it'll be about 10 minutes, so if you need to... to take Mr. Stringer and Mr. Smith back to lock up that with your fine.
All rise.